So I just wanted to put that up as an example of maybe I should sit up. As an example of an intervention study that's happening in California right now. There's been a lot of discussion about what's coming up with sulfate in the East Coast, but some things have actually happened in California related to good movement in the recent years, and this is an example of one such intervention and the effect that it had, not on PM2.5, but on PM0.1, which is what we were interested in this study. And so these are factors that were measured at Sacramento, California, over a one-year period in the PM0.1 size range, and did the elemental analysis, and then did the PMF analysis on top of that. And the factor one there is the technology associated with goods movement that just clearly melted away during the course of this study. And it didn't happen gradually over a one-year period. It happened quite dramatically over a few days or a month or so as the regulations sort of finally hit their last stage where you have to do this by this date. That's when it happened, basically. And so I wanted to frame my comments around this sort of an observation of an intervention-type study. You know, is the existing network good enough to monitor that? Say for PM2.5, forget about the fact that this is PM0.1, which we don't monitor at all, but for PM2.5, would we have picked that up? Well, it was a really dramatic change. It happened sharply. You need about 70 time points of PMF analysis to get a factor resolved before and after. So, you're going to smear out that transition for when that factor was active pretty dramatically if you go from daily sampling to 1 in 6 sampling, say, on your chemical speciation, and you can only do PMF analysis then with much coarser time resolution. So you're going to miss that sharp transition. Would we have picked this up? It appears to be a regional signal. So we measured similar things in Oakland as in Sacramento, and so we think that this is sort of a broad regional signal. It would likely be detected in the existing locations where monitors are sited, but some of the other features of this goods movement program, not so much. There was also a corresponding change in the ship fuel that happened at the same time, and that was harder to detect. It was more localized around the ports, and unless you had monitoring happening close to the ports, you're a little bit blind to that, so you really have to target the populations that were going to be affected by that, which the community of Oakland happens to be. But there had to be a special monitor put in that site. There was not routine monitoring going on there. And unfortunately, that special monitor got put in with not enough time points before the change to actually get the factor resolved for the ships. So we could see the after the change because we had enough data points after that, but it didn't, it takes a lot of effort to get one of these monitors sited and put in and get it operational. And we didn't have enough time points. We only had about, I think, 20 time points before the change, which wasn't sufficient to resolve the ship fuel factor, not the on-road truck factor, but the ship fuel factor. So, I think that in some ways, some of the interventions are going to be challenging to detect with the existing monitoring network. In some ways, the sulfate intervention is very broad regionally, and so it's easy to detect that way. It's going to happen slowly, and so the 1 in 6 or 1 in 3 sampling period might be appropriate for that. But some of these other interventions are not going to be as agreeable to the existing monitoring network, and we may want to do special monitoring to try to handle the features of those. So that was one big comment that I had. Now, the next question, what approaches can be used to fill in the gaps where monitoring isn't sufficient, perhaps? It would be wonderful to have a cheap, accurate, precise monitor for PM that gave you lots of speciation information. And it would have been wonderful 10 years from now, and it will still be wonderful, in the future if we can ever manage to get it developed. But there aren't a lot of great options for that. There are some technologies that are interesting and really promising. Cell phones was explicitly called out in the question, so I'll try to make a few comments related to that. The cell phone technique, the one that I'm familiar with at least, is a way to measure black carbon. If you can draw a sample onto a filter and look at its blackness compared to a calibrated key and take a picture of it with the cell phone camera, you can actually get a fairly reasonable measure of the black carbon concentration in the particles. That's really novel and good, but it doesn't get around the fact that you've got to collect a filter and that it's a manual technique, and so you've got to have someone doing it. Both of those pose challenges to get high time resolution data. I think you can get people trained up and get them doing it. Whether or not they will keep doing it on a daily basis reliably is another good question. And so I think that that technique is really, really valuable for developing countries where we don't have a chemical speciation monitoring network in place. I think that it might actually be kind of interesting indoors, where we're completely blind to what's happening indoors, and it would be interesting to apply it there. I'm not sure if it's going to give a lot of new information in terms of the outdoor network or not, just because it's not automated yet, and it requires effort, and I think that it's going to be challenging to get enough people reliably to put data into that. It's certainly something that has possibilities, but it's not a slam dunk. There are also other techniques. The satellite data is certainly information that can help support our understanding of regional trends of the airborne particle concentrations. From my understanding of the satellite data, I believe that it works better on the East Coast, where you're sulfate-rich, than it does on the West Coast, and you're really challenged to use it in the West Coast. Some of the plots that we've been showing today actually haven't even shown the West Coast when we're looking at the sulfate reductions, because there is no sulfate. It's been gone from California for a long time now. So that's going to be challenging to use that everywhere. It certainly has places where it can be used, but it's not going to be a universal fix. Likewise, models can be used to try to predict some of the exposure fields as well, and that's something that a lot of groups are pursuing right now, but that's not a universal fix either. The emissions inventories are of different quality in different places, and the ability to drive a meteorological model that's accurate enough to support an air quality calculation is easier in some places than it is in others, and so there's not a universal fix for that either. But I think all of those techniques can be used and should be used in places where they work well. Just don't try to push them to places where they're not going to work well, would be my comment related to that. So how should future air quality monitors be sited, which was one of the questions. I think that there is opportunities to take advantage of these intervention studies. The goods movement studies in California are one example of that. Some of that has already happened, and so it's going to be difficult to get the before and after. But I think my comment would be to look at the intervention and to think ahead of time about the right spatial and temporal scales that need to be monitored to take full advantage of that. What I've gained a real appreciation of today is that abrupt changes are easier to detect the signal for if they affect a big enough population. You know, it's somehow this confluence of an abrupt enough change combined with a big enough population to detect the signal that's your key goal. If you have a very, very slow change, you need a very, very big population to detect it, and you're going to need to resolve the confounding factors that also changed along that intervention timescale. So something that happens quickly and over a big enough population to detect would be ideal, but you've got to maybe give some thought about the monitoring network and whether or not enough things are being measured in order to pick that up. Or well enough in the comments to this point. So